Hello. Thanks for coming out in the slush. I've never seen Paris in the snow other than a flurry. This was quite surprising. And I have come off a few days of pretty intensive tasting, as some people in the audience also have done. And I'm normally a very nervous presenter, and without having really thought about this too much, I'm even more nervous right now. But especially because it's a little bit of everything, as Gran said. So at first I thought I was being invited to giving a reading, and I'm at the American Library in Paris, of course I want to read. And then it was, no, let's do a little lecture on natural wine, but also my path into natural wine. So let's see if I remember what to say. I'm going to give you a little bit of background first about what natural wine is, how we've gotten to where we are now, and how I entered into it. This guy is Baldo Capilano, and he died around 2008, right before my first book came out. And this quote of his, he's a winemaker in Barolo, and this quote has always stayed with me because it seems to sum up the cyclical thing that has been going on ever since wine was a commodity, ever since people decided that, oh, they can make money on this thing. This has been the devil, that falsifying wine. But the more there is fake, and I think whether it's about architecture, whether it's about food, culture, politics, that there's always more need for real, and this is exactly what we're talking about when we're talking about the current natural wine situation. So, early adulterations, like I said, it's been going on since pre-Roman times, since as of a few months ago, we know that Georgia was the birthplace of wine. It probably has been going on since that time. And here's, the battle with wine is you have to do what you can to prevent it from turning vinegar. And so all sorts of things were done to hide the vinegar and to make it seem palatable, and that was probably one of the earliest falsifications. Then we get into the Middle Ages with something a little bit more nefarious. So in 1350, it was quite common for people to sell phony wine, and people were punished for it. So I love this one, that he was sentenced to drink his own wine and have the rest poured over his head and get out of the business. But there are all sorts of things going on from the Middle Ages with cornstarch, with arsenic, vinegar and oil, dregs, blah, blah, blah. This goes on. I'm really going fast through the centuries. Get to the 1800s, we get to phylloxera, and I love this one. So Jean-François Audebert published this book, Faire les vins, l'alimentation. It won awards, it was translated several times, and in it was 300 recipes on how to falsify wine to make it look like wine. Of course, around the world there were no grapes, so that you had to do what you could do. It was translated into Italian. I saw a copy of the book on the Canary Islands. It definitely was one of the best sellers of its day. After that, what happened? You had Pasteur, discovered yeast, discovered technology in that way. After World War I, we have the first mechanization in the vineyard. After World War II, we have the chemicals arriving in the vineyard. We have the Dark Ages in the 1970s. And now we're up to maybe modern time. So, to the right is Jules Chauvet, considered the big, granddaddy of the natural wine world. He was a vigneron in Morgon and also a scientist. And he, since the 1950s, they had a problem in the Beaujolais. Beaujolais, Gamay, the home of semi-carbonic maceration and fermentation. And because of the way they did make wine, which was whole berries, carbonic means that the fermentation starts inside the berry instead of a normal, pigeage and outside normal alcoholic fermentation. The pH went high up, and I'm not going to go into the science of this, but there's a relationship in wine between the pH and the acidity, and you need a wine at a healthy acidity to keep it sound. And when you had the pH go up, the acidity went down, and a lot of the wines were going to picolacti, which is lactic bacteria, and you're gone. So a lot of people were falsifying wine in his region. Not falsifying, but as the guy over there, the other grandfather of the natural wine business, Marcel LaPierre, used to say when he started making wine in the 70s, there were two tits of the Beaujolais, he said, and one was sugar and the other was sulfur. So basically you would pick underripe, and then you would yeast, you would add sugar to keep the fermentation going, and you would sulfur the hell out of the wine. As a result, his wine was terrible and he couldn't drink it. He found Jules Chauvet doing all of these experiments on how to make wine healthily without sulfur, without the use of sugar, without the use of yeast, and also going back to organic viticulture. They teamed up, and in 1979, the first experiments happened, and that really was the birth of the natural wine movement. What happened is that Marcel really liked very much what he was making, and it was a game of telephone. So one friend told another, and then you had the gang of five in the Beaujolais. So you would have Jean Foyard, a famous vigneron, was among them. And there was a woman in Paris, and she had a boyfriend who had a wine bar. And he actually is the current editor and publisher of the Rouge et Blanc, which is a very fine wine publication in France. And she said, you got to see what's going on in my hometown in, you know, Morgon. Said some people are doing some really, really good winemaking there. You got to come down. He goes down. The wine is nothing like he's ever tasted. And thus was born in 1982. He claims to be the first natural wine bar. So that was 1982, pre-internet. Things worked a lot more slow back then. And finally, now comes the big question for those of you who are not totally intimate with the wine world. What is natural wine? So I'm talking about natural wine. What do we call it? Well, so you have to start with the natural, organic or equivalent farming. I say nothing added, nothing taken away, and I'm laughing because my friend Bianca, who was coming over with me here, said, I don't like this thing, nothing added, nothing taken away. It's not a good definition. And I counter that it is the beginning of the conversation, because when I say nothing added or nothing taken away, you say, well, what are you taking out and what are you putting in? And then I get to tell you that there are over 72 perfectly legal additives that one can add into wine. And personally, I really don't want any of them, except I admit I will take some at times, some minimal amounts of added sulfites. I really don't think it is the devil the way a lot of people do. There you go, maybe 20. But why be dogmatic about it? But as I said at the beginning, the point is to do as little as possible to that wine to avoid it turning into vinegar, but also deliver something that's delicious. And so for those of us who believe in natural wine, we believe it is more expensive for place, and now I go into a formal presentation here. I really think it's more lively. I do think it's more healthful. We have we talk about a wine being digestible. It feels good in the body. And it actually, one of the things that I did forget, one of the early movements towards the drive in natural wine was to be able to make a wine where you can drink more with fewer hangovers. It was very, and it still is, a very, very hard drinking crowd. And so this is a tiny little revolution that took more than 30 years to get to where we now, which I guess all of you live in Paris pretty much, where it is more defining what we're talking about when we're talking about good wine. And I think in a few years, we really are going to stop talking about natural wine. We'll be accepting maybe a little bit less hardcore wine, a little bit less, you know, the way it was, you know, the expression of, you know, c'est bio, c'est bon. So it's just because it's organic, it's good. Maybe it won't be just because it's natural, it's good and it gets a pass. But the basics are organic viticulture, no added yeast, no additives to a marketing idea to shape the notion of what a wine should taste like. But really what we're talking about is wine, and the best wine that was made before World War II, sometimes 1950. If you get some of the older bottles, most of them had minimal sulfites. They were native yeast, and it was organic viticulture. At this point, I gotta have a PowerPoint because I don't know where I'm going next. Oh, yes, going to my mother. So we have all this background, and I have a mother. She's 93. She goes to work every day from Long Beach, Long Island into New York. She drives maybe 4 hours a day on a bad day. And I get most of my best material from her because, you know, guilt is very motivating. And as she says to me, probably once a month, this is what you do for a living. You write about wine. And that really bugged me for a very long time, and on a bad day, it still bugs me a great deal, because she really would have liked me to have been a cardiologist like my brother was, and of course. But yeah, up until year 2000, I was like any other schnook writing about wine, and I thought I knew something, even though I'd only been writing about it for 10 years. I taste a wine, I'm excited about it, I want to tell the world what to drink. And, you know, when you think about it, I wasn't a great novelist. You know, really, what was I doing? And I never thought of myself as a wine writer. I didn't really want to be a wine writer, but more and more I became known as one. But something happened in the year 2000. And that was the year that I wrote Food and Wine Magazine Official Wine Guide. And it was a wine guide where I had to taste a lot of wine and comment on the wine and recommend wine. And I was hating almost every wine that I was drinking. And I thought this was going to be a very, very small book. Except I found one piece of the world that still had wines that excited me, and that happened to be France, mostly in the Loire. And I did more investigation, and if you were drinking wine around 2000, it was the height of the Robert Parker era, where everything tasted oaky, 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 and everything tasted like cherry vanilla ice cream. And it was boring, and it was dead. I thought the problem was just oak. And then I started doing more investigations. At that point, I started realizing all the stuff that you can put in wine, and all of the machines that can change the nature of wine, the concentrator, reverse osmosis, dialysis, that wine was being created by marketers in order to create certain flavors. And I was just, gosh, it was so much more than just oak. And, you know, quite primarily the designer yeast that changed the flavor and fragrance of wine. So at that point, I really felt that I walked through that looking glass, and I never walked back, because what started to happen then is that I became a whistleblower, and I was pretty much banned from writing about wine. None of the major publications wanted me. They'd let me write about food. I wrote about design, but no, not about wine. It became too dangerous, and it's really bizarre. I mean, I'm sorry, guys, we're talking about wine, but it was important. I actually felt that there was a tremendous fraud being pushed on global drinkers, that wine is made in the vineyard was the biggest piece of crap being told. It really wasn't true at all, because wine was being made in the laboratory, not in the vineyard. And so it became, I started feeling a little bit less guilty when I started realizing that I did become kind of a mouthpiece for a growing movement that was committed to working well in the vineyard to creating a natural and healthful product, and they had trouble bringing it to the bottle. There were plenty of natural wine bars in Paris, but you could not really get the wines readily elsewhere. And so that brings me up to around 2005. Like every writer, I wanted to write a book. And I thought, okay, I'm going to write a book, how Robert Parker ruined my drinking life. And I thought nobody would want to buy it. Lo and behold, I was able to sell it. And that really screwed up my life as a wine writer. It actually got worse instead of better. The next book was Naked Wine, and I wrote that because I could see that down the line, natural wine was going to become a commodity and it will begin to be falsified and co-opted, which actually I think is happening right this second. But so I wanted people to have a book that at least told people the history of where natural wine came from, the history of falsification, and to get the basics down. So I wrote, what is the name of this book? For the Love of Wine, My Odyssey Through the World's Most Ancient Wine Culture. I have to say, in the past 15 years, subtitles have become just ridiculous, and I probably have the longest subtitles. And this is, I fell in love with Georgia because, well, it was just so authentic. At the time, it had such a moving story of people coming out of Soviet times and going back to a way of making wine that they never let go all through 70 years of the Soviet era. And it was quite difficult to hold on to that. Actually, through wars, they never stopped making wine in a very, very ancient way. So what you're seeing there is very cuvée, which is their amphora. It's a very typical Marani, they call it, wine cellar. And they get all sorts of sizes of jars underneath there, and that's Arshil. And I want to read a little bit about being in Arshil's vineyards, which may be some of the most, I don't know, I kind of had a hallucinogenic experience there. I can't find it, so I'm just going to go here. Just a little tiny bit. So not only was the soil intoxicating, the air was too. I stood up, bent my head back, and inhaled the hills, the sounds, and the perfume. I was heady with the sensuality of it all. Knit into the insects, birds, were the grapes, peaches, plums, apricots, shade, and sun, a thriving sexual frenzy of fertility. Summer was about to burst. Everything was in balance in a robust ecosystem. I thought about all the world's winemakers trying to study biodiversity. They were busy with co-planting beneficial herbs, flowers, clovers in the vineyards, but there it was in his vineyard with no architect trying to design it. People talk about biodynamics. They take inspiration from the kind of homeopathic farming. They pay homage to its father, Rudolf Steiner. To hell with it, I thought. I was in a completely different thought zone, and I was heading for a rant of a very different dimension. Where I was going was Freud. Farming and Freud. Freud's civilizations and his discontents was suddenly screamingly relevant to me, especially as the father of psychotherapy counterpointed instinctual freedom with civilization's demand for conformity. What could be more illustrative of this than the theater of a vineyard? I started to see that the vine was the equivalent of a chicken longing to run free. Men exercised control over the wild grape, placed it in a pen. They took a vine's frenetic arms and tied them onto wires. They stole the vine out of the natural environment and created tools and chemicals to help the plant adapt to a new home. It's inevitable to want to tame the wild vine in the way, but it comes with a cost. Why had I never noticed before that with all the vineyards in the world I've visited and I've been to beauties, lands that have been cared for by passionate people, they lacked what Georgia had? This particular vineyard seemed to embody it all. All of those in the world, hard at work trying to revive soils that had been poisoned, and all of those had given lip service to biodiversity needed to visit Georgia. anyway, I was truly like in a fit of a frenzy there. And I remember they were like, Alice, are you okay? And I felt like I had dropped acid. I was totally tripping. And the next book, which just is, so it's just a bunch of rocks. I had been trying to stop writing about wine for a long time now. Maybe it's going back to my Jewish mother who tells me this is what you do, what are you doing? I mean, you're really not adding anything to the world. So I was trying to sell a memoir based on a serial killer that I escaped when I was 14. And an editor said, we don't want that from you. We want a book for beginners about wine. And I'm like, I don't want to write a book on for beginners about wine. But I said, okay, I'm going to write a proposal, and it's going to be the geekiest wine proposal ever for beginners. And quite frankly, you know that you, I don't, you know, you walk in to a wine bar, and maybe you say, you want the Gamay, the Pinot Noir. And in America, it's particularly bad with people like saying, I'll have the Malbec or the Cabernet Sauvignon. And it really is annoying me because that is irrelevant. I really thoroughly believe that the grape is irrelevant. And what used to be before the 1980s, people used to drink place. So this is my attempt to bring people back to drinking by place. It doesn't make a difference because, quite frankly, you're drinking the vigneron and you're drinking, I think I want something like crunchy from the Loire. Well, what could that be? It could be a lot of different things. So what I did was I organized the book into igneous, sedimentary, metamorphic, two pages on geology most, and then I really talk about the impact of the soil. And I should say, when I gave it to a geologist to fact check, he was really like, do not thank me in the acknowledgments because it is not soil, it is rock. So, but basically, you go to visit anybody, they're going to say, my soils are. So just to say that when we talk about soils, we talk about bedrock. But in it, I really have created the book that I wish somebody else would have written because, frankly, it was a pain in the ass to write, and I've never been so miserable in my life. And now I look at the book, it really is pretty good. It really does give you a basis of what kind of impact, you know, that limestone has on this particular grape type. And I think it is a very different way of exploring the world. So you can say, I'm going to explore, you know, wines on schist. And then you can basically travel the world and drink schist for a couple of weeks and then move on to basalt. And so who knows what, I do know what my next book is going to be. So I think there's one more book before I'm able to stop writing about wine, and that's due in July. and then we'll see what happens and whether I do find my way to becoming a cardiologist or not. But at this point, I would love to take questions from you because that was a totally free rambling conversation about Alice and wine and the natural wine world. And I know I didn't answer a lot of specificities about natural wines. If you want to hit me with those, go ahead. Or anything. You're based in Paris?
Yes.
You've got things a little bit easier here, but a lot of times you'll see, actually I'm going to screw up here, non ajouté de soufre or something like that. Different ways of saying that they don't add sulfur, though it's bigger than that, or they'll have some thing that this is a natural wine. There, or you can look at an association that they belong to, like Les Vincent. Les Vincent is a group of people, and there aren't too many in this group, but that work naturally in the vineyard and are very hardcore, no sulfur added people. Beyond de Vin is not so bad. So if you get the certifying label, you get a hint. But the best thing that you can do is go to your caviste and start recognizing them, because there's what the EU is now trying to determine some sort of designation for natural lawn, but what they're really going to do to that, I don't know. So it really is educated buyer. Oh, I was thinking about air during vinification, which I've been thinking a lot about lately.
Oh, no, I mean air during for the growth of the grapes.
Of course.
We can talk about that.
Well, actually, the reason that I picked rock here is in full onslaught of climate change, everything is changing. What we're going to be planting is changing. The oxygen and the ozone levels are changing. And what is not changing is the rock. And that is basically my organizing principle, because that's the only thing that is not going to change. But yes, I am certainly climate, sunshine, the quality of the light is all impacts the vine dramatically. Absolutely. In fact, in New York, without a doubt, some completely famous wine shops like Chamber Street and Discovery, and most of the best ones will have many natural wines. But what has happened in the past few years, it's gone outside of the coast, so it's no longer just in New York and California, but you have natural wine bars in Portland, Maine. You have Naples, Florida, for God's sakes. So it's basically people are. The growth of natural wine importation in the United States is huge. Most people are basically selling in every state. So it is huge. But the hot spots are going to be New York, California, Chicago, Boston starting to get with it. You have natural wine bars in Vermont, and it is all over the place. It is no longer just an urban phenomenon. Well, shipping long distances, you're going to have to use refrigerated containers.
Of course.
And for the longest time, people didn't and went cheap. And you treat any wine that way unless you really like super dose it with not only sulfur but clay. You're going to have a spoiled wine no matter what. In fact, natural wine, I think as long as you give it time to recoup, can react a lot better than a conventional wine. And also it really depends on the wine itself. So just because it's natural doesn't mean that it's made well. I don't have a lot of great wine storage in my apartment, and I have my two little refrigerators, and then it's I keep my air conditioner on economy mode in the summer. And usually the wines that are the most natural are the ones that have survived the longest. So I totally debunk that. I absolutely give it absolutely no. You just have to respect the wine. And we all get travel sick. The wines get travel sick. You need to have it. And that wine that it could have, sounds like that wine really got beat up.
Or it wasn't done fermenting.
Yeah, it probably wasn't done fermenting, which happens a lot. If people are putting they're bottling way too early. But the thing about your friends, your sommelier friends in the States, and certainly, and one of the slides that used to be in this thing is, and we're still having the debate, and we're still having to explain this thing called natural wine, when it's, you're still having to explain why you work organically instead of chemically, and why you don't want to put crap in your wine. And it is, somebody will have one wine that they don't like, and they say, I don't like natural wine. It's a phenomenon that I don't quite understand. I suppose I can understand. I can have one conventional wine. Actually, I have a lot of conventional wines, and I don't like them. I can't drink them anymore. And that I will say without a doubt, that I just can't. That's what spirit is for. Well, I do want to say that in the battle for wine and love, and in the year 2000 or 2001, I was not using the term natural wine at all. That's something that came later as knew it was just like real wine that I was talking about. And there was. The wine that was basically my come to Jesus wine was Clos Rochebranche Cope in the 98 vintage. And Clos Rochebranche is no longer, you know, they sold their vines a few years ago, but that was it. And it was such a pure expression of terroir. I was just stunned, and it was just so pure in the middle of all the stuff that I would, all this confabulation that I was drinking. So that was it. Actually, one of my most, back in the days when I was blogging, one of the most popular blog posts that I've ever done was exactly on this, being in at the train station in Lyon, and all of a sudden it hitting me when I saw somebody eating chips nature. I was like, oh, I get it. But natural wine went along the same progression as natural foods back in the 70s and the 80s. And actually, in Naked Wine, there's a whole chapter on the statistics and the money that the food industry put into trying to squelch natural food, and also the abuses. So the same abuses happen in food as well. But I think it actually, it was just supposed to be just plain, just wine. I think exactly that's where it came out of. And then for some reason it turned into just wine without sulfur. Well, one thing to motivate them, I think the good people where we are now, there's not enough good natural wine for the demand. And so they're selling their wine. You know, and actually one reason that I wrote the Georgian book is to let them, to give them enough attention that they would not be tempted to go down the route of technology, and that they found their people, which they did. And so there's plenty of economic incentive. And, you know, all you have to do is, like, look in the Muscadet. Muscadet is, like, most people can't sell their wine. You go to the good producers, the natural wine producers there, they're all sold out. They do not, and the same thing, it's the natural wine producers that save Beaujolais. And it's the natural wine producers that are going to be saving, like, Emilia Romagna in Italy. So it is... you know, it's a little bit like the artists move into a rundown area, and then all of a sudden, what's the next thing is like, then the prices go up and then they're going to be kicked out, which actually is starting to happen in Loire and other places. But if you're making a good natural wine, you have incentive because you can sell it. The demand is huge. I am fearful of a definition because I feel that, you know, identify and destroy. Yeah. And there's no way that you can have a wiggle room in a definition. So what are we going to, you know, I really don't want the extremis of actually zero sulfur, which will lead the way to incredibly, like basically giving the pass on industrial wines made without sulfur, because people will think that is what a natural wine is. So then we get to the ingredient list. And maybe that's what has to happen, but then the amount of bureaucracy around that is going to be nightmarish. So do I know? It's like you have, you know, you put it in your mouth, if you like it, fine. But there are a lot of people like won't like it when they find out it is not a zero sulfur wine. I don't know. It is a conundrum. Right. Well, it's like what I usually tell people is that out of all of those, you have to make sure it says wine and not the grapes. And if you're going for biodynamic wine, that's at least closer, the closest that you have to understand to natural. So in the EU, if you're going to have a bio wine, if it's certified organic, you basically can use any additive as long as it's an organic additive. And there are a lot of processes that you can use, and it is a pretty It's a pretty high allowed sulfur addition. We didn't talk about what added sulfides do to a wine, but it really, I mean, I think about it as far as hairspray on a wine fixes it. And so that's one big difference. So you really cannot count on. Now, a natural wine means that you, ideally, that there are people who are natural who don't necessarily grow organically, but ideally growing organically, and then you're not using any additives except maybe some sulfur. It's very, very simple. And like, keep in mind that there are over 72 additives allowed. So basically, if you're using that word basically a lot, you will most likely encounter added yeast, acidity, bacteria, enzymes, tannin addition. Let me think about one of the other basic before you get too far. That kind of thing. You're not going to have any of that in a natural wine. But you can have an organic. But it refers to when then it's organic grapes or not.
Sure.
But thank you. That's not so basic. That is a question that actually always needs to be reclarified, and it's probably one of the most popular questions I get asked. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.